So let's get started. So we're going to spend the next 40 minutes talking about annotations. We'll cover both a bit of theory and practice. So one problem you may have with Python sometimes is that the code can be obscure. Practical example, this is a function validate. It takes an argument, a form, it's usually HTTP stuff, web stuff, data, and it does form.validate, it calls data. You don't know what are the possible forms, you don't know what are the types of data. So you're a bit lost, and if somebody tells you fix the bug which is happening here, you're a bit lost, you're lost again. And maybe the function accepts multiple types of data, and you don't know it. So you're not sure what exactly it should be called with. There's a doc string, so it's documented. And the doc string, it's completely useless. So it's a very common case. If you work on legacy code base, you have theoretical documentation, but it's not very useful. And because you don't know exactly what it's going to do, maybe you will pass a wrong type of data and you will break production code. And you don't know it. When it's here, it's not sure that you can capture it with unit tests. So type annotations aims to fix basically this problem. A very brief history. So it was introduced in Python 3.0, so by Guido von Rossum, as part of the effort to convert Python 2 to Python 3. Initially, it was function argument annotation. So the notion of typing was not in the specification, but it was very quickly used this way. So in Python 3.5, it was officially named type annotation. So you can now provide type information within functions, function arguments. And since it's used more and more, there were some improvements done in Python 3.6 and Python 3.7, which was released 4 months ago. So what does the syntax look like? If you were at the previous talk, you have a small idea already. It's quite straightforward. You have your function, the argument name, as usual, and then a colon, and you describe the type, in this case, an integer. If you have a default value, you need to put the annotation before the default value. So second argument, colon, type description equal default value, an empty string in this case. And the return value, you put an arrow on, you specify the type of the return value, and then you have the colon. If you work with a method, it's exactly the same, except that you don't have to type annotate self. That would be annoying. So you can skip that part, but apart from that, just like a function, colon, type, arrow, return value. You can also annotate variables, so that's only with Python 3.6. Very similar syntax, very straightforward as well. Python tries to remain consistent, so the variable name, colon, the type, equal the value, and you can even provide just raw annotation. So in this case, you're not even using the variable, you're doing nothing with it but declare its type. When you are using classes, it's possible to declare the type of the instance variable. So in this case, you're saying that C, when you will be using self.c, it will be a floating point. So when you start using it, that's a floating point, that's good. And you can also, just same syntax above, when you do the initialization of your class, you can declare the type immediately. So the syntax, I think you can all get it quite quickly. Now you've got the basic types that you can annotate with, and you've got some more elaborate types. So if you want to say this is going to be a list, you can use, so it's a bit unusual syntax, capital L, list, square bracket, the type, and you get your list. So this is to specify that this is a list containing integers. This list, you will import it from the typing module. If you want to have a list that contains different kind of types, you need an extra keyword, which is named union. So square bracket again. You're specifying that the type here can be either a Boolean or an integer, and that the list will contain this type. And always the syntax, colon, type, equal, data. For tuple, so usually you define exactly what's the tuple going to be. So in this case, I'm declaring a tuple with three fields. First one is an integer, second one a string, third one is a floating point value. And you can also declare a tuple with non-specific length, but a specific content with a three-dot syntax. So that's the equivalent of the above, a tuple which contains float, whatever the length. And let's continue. For example, for a dictionary, so the syntax, so this is always imported from the typing module, and you specify the type of the key, here a string, and the type of the content, an integer. And of course, you can combine everything. So school coordinates here, I'm declaring a variable, which is mapping, it's a dictionary, which is mapping a name to a tuple of two integers. So here I'm doing just a declaration, and here's the assignment, name of the school, some coordinates. And you can also annotate with none. So here, a function which takes the type none. So in Python, none is a bit specific. It's both a type of a value and a value. So it's a specific type, none, that can take only one value, none. So here, I'm saying that this function accepts the type none. It means that it can only be called with one very specific value, none, which is not very useful, because usually you want to call with different kind of values. So none is always used together with another type when you're using none in the typing context. So here I'm declaring a function which can accept either the none value or an integer and returns an integer. And since this syntax is very common, an extra keyword was introduced, which is named optional. So when you're saying optional square bracket integer, you're saying it's either none or something else. And you see, obviously, here there's a default value of none. So if you check the typing module, I will not go into all the possibilities because we are in limited time, but there are plenty of stuff. You can do also duck typing. So instead of describing with precise types like list, tuple, string, you can describe by properties. So this is a sequence, this is a mapping, this is something you can iterate on. This is something where you can use the len function. So there are plenty of duck typing classes. If you check the Python documentation, there's the module also named abstract base classes, which contains plenty of classes to describe types by their attributes, and all of them have an equivalent in the typing module. You can also do some advanced stuff, so type aliasing, type generic, subtyping, and there's a typing joker named any. So this is just to highlight the potential before we move on to some practice. And sometimes you will need to do type conversion with CAST. So you can check the typing module on the main tool which I'm going to talk about is MyPy, which has also excellent documentation. So where do we stand? Good. So now that we have put type annotations, what does Python do with it? So annotations, they are valid expressions, so Python needs to compute them, and they are evaluated during the module loading. Okay, simple. And then the result of this evaluation is stored in the function object. And then that's it. Python itself does nothing with the type annotation except to store them. So if you want to verify the type annotations, you need to run external tools. So it means that the Python, the language itself, did not become statically typed. It's just that we provide static type facilities to be used externally. So what about the tools available? So we have the first one is the PyCharm IDE, which provides an inspection mode. So it's quite nice because you can, as you type, it will tell you if you are passing the wrong type to a method. So instant feedback is very, very comfortable. However, the analysis is not as deep as the two other tools which I'm going to mention. And we've got two high-level tools. So the first one is MyPy, the second one is Pyre. Both of them are open source, written in Python. So MyPy was really the first one to be introduced. It's by the Guido's team at Dropbox, and it was in the what created all the type annotation in Python movement, let's say. And Pyre was released recently by Facebook, so at the last PyCon conference. It's written in OCaml, so a bit more difficult to address. And it doesn't run on Windows, so some kind of limitation. Maybe they will lift it in the future. For the rest of my talk, I'm going to focus on MyPy, because this is the reference, the first one introduced on what everybody refers to. So how do you start with for type annotation with your code? So if you have the luck to work on a new code base, where you start from scratch, just set it immediately as a rule. Everything should be type annotated, and all the type annotation should pass. Quite simple. You will see that it's a very good rule. If you work on an existing code base, and if you work in a company, that's usually the case. You arrive in the company, but there were people before you. You have to start small, one module at a time. You don't say, I will annotate everything. It's too much of a task. So you start small. You do one module, then you improve gradually. All the annotation tools are designed to work with gradual improvement. So you can work with just one module out of 10,000 modules annotated, you still get some benefits. Of course, you want to put the static type verification in whatever you are using to verify your software. So that could be continuous integration, nightly builds, non-regression tests. So in practice, we'll see how to run MyPy. So let's say you start, you add an annotation to mymodule.py to verify it. MyPy --strict, mymodule.py. The --strict is useful because it will tell you if you forgot to add annotation to any function. So in this example, function is missing return type annotation. This is an error which I do very often. On MyPy will tell me with a strict mode. When you're done with annotating one module, you want to check the whole code base against the module. So in this case, you leave out the --strict because maybe your whole code base is not annotated. But still, MyPy will check the consistency of all your call to my module. And here I found an error. A function in my module is called with an incompatible type, float instead of integer. So you get information that it was misused. And then, once you have done your type annotation here, you've fixed all the errors here. It's important to run your tests. First, because it's a good practice. Second, because type annotation can have side effects which make the code a bit difficult to execute. So sometimes you have to go through extra step to make your code both type annotated and valid Python code. So where do you want to add type annotation? So obviously all your functions, all your methods. On the variables, if you provide the value, MyPy will deduce immediately that this is an integer, so no need to type annotate every variable, except if the value is not, the deduced type is not correct. So in France, VAT rate, we have the standard VAT rate 20, which is an integer, and the reduced VAT, which is 5.5. So this is not an integer, so this will trigger an error. So in this case, the correct way to declare it is VAT rate colon float equal 20. You also need to add type annotations on all empty containers, because when you see this, MyPy doesn't know what is the content type. Probably strings, but okay. So if you pass the information, okay, names is a list of string, but it's initialized to an empty container. MyPy is happy. It will help you to find a usage of names. So this is true for mostly every container. So in the, for example, here dictionary, I just did the declaration. I can use it as an empty container. So sets, dictionary, lists, tuples, if they are empty, you want to specify what is their content. So now let's move on to practice. So you get started, you think annotation is cool, you take your first file, contains two classes. First method contains use another A, so you have to pass an extra argument of type A, the same class, it returns none. And there's a second class which uses basically optionally a class B, which is defined just a few lines below. So far, so good, quite straightforward. You run MyPy, it passes, you're good. You run Python, boom. What is going on? So it's complaining that name A is not defined and name B is not defined. What actually happens is that when Python runs the code, I said annotations have to be valid expressions. So here the expression A is not valid. It will be valid starting from here. When the class definition is finished, Python will know that this is a class which exists, and you can start using it. The same goes for class B. At this step, it's not defined. It will be fully defined here. That's why I said you need to run your end-to-end tests after adding annotations. So the fix is quite simple. If you are using Python 3.7, you can do a future import annotations. This will become standard in Python 4.0, so in 3 or 4 years. But if you are 3.7, this is a simple fix. And in this case, it passes everything. Another fix, just put the name of the class inside quotes. So this is what everybody is doing today. On MyPy, knows that if it's a string, he will extract it so that he gets what you mean. It passes. Second example, you have a class, again, you add annotation, so this step initialization value, it's either an integer or none. You will store the current step, self.step, from this value. And there's a function to retrieve it, a method to retrieve it, getStep, that returns an integer. And that integer is actually the instance variable, self.step plus one. quite straightforward. You start running MyPy. A problem. Unsupported operand types for plus. Left side is optional of integer, and right side is an integer. What does it mean? You have a bug, and MyPy found it. Self.step, if you don't pass any information, it could be none. Or none plus one doesn't exist. This will break. How do you go with fixing this? So the simplest is just you will check if self.step is none before using it. So the correct way of checking is self.step is none. I used to use a lot of equal, personally, in my code, so this is bad practice. It's better to check it like this. And it's also a bad practice because MyPy will only recognize this form. So it will force the good practice on you. So in this case, you've dealt with both cases, none and integer. And now MyPy is happy, and your code is better. Another solution. Instead of letting self.step be known, you initialize with. So this is a typical syntax where you say if step init is known, take the second part of the value. So self.step will either be an explicit integer passed here, or zero if this was known. And now the method is correct. It's always an integer. Another solution is to provide a bit of default. Instead of initialing with none, if no argument is passed to class A, put directly an integer. So this becomes always an integer, and this is always valid. Still, another case. When you work on existing code bases, the code is much more complex than this, and sometimes it's too complicated to check for none and to have right default values. So there's a specific MyPy options to say, okay, no strict optional. Don't care about optional. I'm taking care of this myself. So MyPy, don't complain about this. So in this specific code, you would have the bug, but you know that your class is never called with none. And so this is a case where dynamically you would have a different behavior. Why did I come back to this? some magic happened. I'm not at the right place. where was it? Yep. I click at on the wrong button. So up. On the last solution. So I say disable non-checking up. And a last solution is just to silence the error. In this simple case, it's not worth it. On existing code bases, sometimes it's just too complicated to get the static type right, so you just want to say, okay, ignore. So that's a way to telling MyPy to ignore. A comment with type colon ignore. Okay, let's see a third example. Here we have a more complex type. Something I forgot to say is that the type annotation syntax, I show the syntax for Python 3. A similar syntax exists for Python 2, so you're not limited to your Python version. It's based on comments. I won't show it here, but if you have Python 2, you can still type annotate it. So let's get back to this example. So here, more complex function, we have a function named upper. It accepts a thing argument, and this thing could be either, it's a union, so it could be either some string, some bytes, or a list of strings. And it returns a string. That's for sure. So you're checking if type of thing it's a list, so that's the third case. You put it together into a string with join. So now thing is always a string, and you return thing.upper. Quite straightforward. So if this is not a list, you just return the upper value of thing. So this is a capitalized version of the string upper. so you run your MyPy. It complains. Argument 1 to join of string has incompatible union, blah, blah, blah. It expected an iterable of string. What is happening here is that, so join must work on iterable, usually that's list of strings. But he say he receives a complex case, but actually that's not the case. With the code here, you've excluded the first two versions, so you're only passing list of string. But what is actually happening is that MyPy did not understand that this is a type check. So it did not understand that you're dealing with a list case. How do you fix this? And it also complains about the return type, since same story, it says it's a big type and you should only have string. So the proper way to fix this is to use isInstance. So the check for the type is different. I'm checking that thing actually inherit from the type list. You can use this with generic classes, of course. And now MyPy knows that isInstance is a type check, and it will not complain about the join. Let's see it. I'm running MyPy. So join is OK, but it still complains about returning. So what does it say? Return value, the type is union of string or bytes, but I was expecting only string. And you know what? This is an actual bug. The code here is not correct. I didn't take care of the bytes case. So the correct code, so MyPy found the bug again. That's why I want to emphasize it will help you find a lot of bugs like this. So the correct way to deal with this is to add another isInstance check. So this is for list of string, this is for bytes. If this is bytes, I'd convert the bytes into a string. And then I return the thing, the string, capitalized. So this will pass MyPy. So yeah, we found the bug. I want to look at another from another angle. Let's say that you have some complicated code which does exactly what we did just before, but instead of using isInstance, we're still using the legacy syntax, type of thing is list, or if type of thing is bytes, you use the same code. So with this code, MyPy will not understand that you did some type checks and will complain. It's not always possible in real code to replace this kind of thing with isInstance, or sometimes you will have a complicated isInstance check that MyPy will not understand. So you can pass information to MyPy using cast. So here you're saying thing, actually it's the same thing, but it's actually a list of string. So you're telling MyPy, forget everything you know, trust me, this is a list of string. So you can now handle it here. Same thing here, you're saying, okay, trust me, these are bytes. Trust me, all the code path before, they lead to a string, and now you can just verify that thing.upper is still correct. So in real code, real case, you want to avoid this as much as possible, but it's not always possible. You have some time to help MyPy to figure out things. A quote from some people who wrote the MyPy documentation on Guido von Rossum, they say sometimes Python is a very dynamic language. Probably we are all familiar with it. And we are talking here about static typing information. It doesn't always mix very well. So sometimes you can force the dynamic nature into static stuff, and sometimes it's just too hard. So keep in mind that given the dynamic nature of Python, it's not always possible to type annotate everything precisely. So here it will pass, as I said. We gave enough information. On my last example, I'm getting back to the first function I showed in the beginning. So the validate form data, the form validates the data. We don't know exactly what it does. Let's say that you've dug through the code and you found that it's actually a user form. It has a method validate. Okay, it takes a data. The way to validate this data is a bit strange. It calculates something with data of 1 multiplied by data of 2, modulo data of 3, and it will store the result in data of 4, and then it will check whether data of 4 is greater than 21. It's strange, but in some cases, this is a function with side effects, which you would not expect from the name. So it's a bad practice, but bad practice exists. And let's say that we have some production code and a production code function, which will create a user form. It will pass a list from 0 to 9, and it will return validate this form, this data. Looks correct, the list, so the validation of the data will work fine, so everything looks good. And then there's a new developer who joined the project, and he's an experienced Python developer, and he say, data list 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There's a better way to do this. It's called range. This is much better, much readable, high-level function. You're good. Passes all unit tests. You change one type of item. You put it into production. And then a user enters some data, and you need to validate it. And something happens. Range object does not support item assignment. The range object is an iterator. So you cannot say data of 4 equals something. This is only possible on your mutable object. So by changing the type, you've created a bug in your production. But you know what? Actually, this did not happen. Because that developer, he was in this room, he listened to this talk, and he did better. What he did first, he said, OK, user form, I will type annotate it. This requires a list of integers. And then he said, OK, validate, I will also annotate it. It takes one kind of form, user form, and one kind of data, list of integers. And then production code, I will just annotate that it returns bool. If it's not annotated, MyPy will not analyze the function. So you need to put some annotation inside the function so that MyPy analyzes it. He puts the written code, and then he runs MyPy. On MyPy is kind enough. Incompatible type. You're passing a range. I expected a list of integers. So MyPy can really find bugs. So this is the most interesting example where you've got series of calls. So in real code, in real life, you've got much deeper call hierarchy, and you don't know what types you are passing. And static type information will help you. So the proper fix, you convert range into a list first. And then MyPy is happy with your production code, and Python is happy with it as well. Okay. A last thing, I will talk about monkey type, strange name. So it's a tool released by Facebook, and there's an equivalent tool released by Dropbox. You can see that basically type annotations, there are two big supporters, Dropbox and Facebook, which happen to be the companies using the highest number of Python code base in the world. So we are talking about hundreds of thousands of lines of Python code. And both of them support type annotations. They support the tools, they provide the tools, they will help you. So monkey type if we get back to the validate example, which I love, it's difficult to, I say this is a user form, but usually when you have a code base, it's difficult to analyze, especially with a generic name like validate. So maybe there are other cases which were missed. I'm not sure actually in practice which kind of form it's used. And I'm not sure that I captured all the types of data it's called with. But there's somebody who knows exactly what is the reality. It's actually Python. When you execute your code, Python can look at the types and see what you are actually using. This is what a monkey type does. So instead of doing a Python all unit test, you will do my monkey type run, so it will execute like Python, but it will record every function call, all the types which are used, and it will store them internally in a database. You also want to run your integration test or end-to-end test or whatever they are called. You can even run some production code, except that it will run slowly, so be careful, but it's interesting to capture live data. And with this, you've created an internal database of all the types which are used in your code. Then you do something very simple, monkey type. Apply, validate here is the name of the module. So this would be in a file validate.py, and you're saying apply static typing to validate.py, and the result. Your code is magically transformed into this. So he will rewrite your source code so that it's annotated. So form, what is so in practice is that it's used with two kinds of forms. It's either a user form or an admin form. Data, it's always a list of integers, and it always returns bool. So there's another tool which does exactly the same thing, PyAnnotate. I show monkey type because it's simpler. But okay. So we came to our conclusion. Type annotation will help you to find bugs. The bigger the code base, the more it will help. And it feels much safer as a developer when you want to change something to know that you specify what you are changing. You want to pass a new type of data to validate. Is it good? Is it bad? If you have type annotation, it's already a hint of what good or bad means. It's also a good way of documenting your code. Even if you don't run MyPy, it's very helpful to know that what types you are dealing with and what types you are expected to return. If you combine it with data classes like the previous code, you can even define strong interfaces which are actually code. All the developers who used it, they love it. They say, okay, it's much better than before. And they keep using it, they keep improving it. So MyPy is a moving project. It's evolving. There are releases like once a month to improve on slide details on everything. Remember, though, that not everything in Python can be converted into static type checking. So sometimes you've got some difficult cases. You will have to use some typing joker, like any, or you will just ignore the typing information. You will use cast to force the information on MyPy. So this is common practice. Don't see it as something very bad. You should not use it regularly, but it's there for a good reason. So you should go step by step, adding annotation, one module, two modules, three modules, verify the general consistency. And of course, well, this should be a point on its own. MyPy has excellent documentation, so does the typing module, so you can use it. Use it, it's very nice. There's also, in the last PyCon US, there was two presentations about static type annotation, so they were also very good. You can check that. You will go more into the syntax details. There are more possibilities that I could show here. And of course, monkey type, PyAnnotate, especially in big code bases. If you have big code bases, usually you have a bigger production test, so you have a lot of information which you can extract from what exists today to put the type annotations. You don't have to start from nothing. So that was it. So I'm working in IDEMIA in Bordeaux. IDEMIA is recruiting, if you're interested. So the slides are online on the PyParis website. Maybe not yet, but in a few minutes. And you can also find them on GitHub. And we have time for questions, and I'm perfectly on time. I'm very happy about this. Wow. Yes?
Yes, so I have a question. Do type annotations on MyPy work for complex containers like pandas, data frames? And in general, if I want to make it work with a container, does it need to be already integrated into typing on MyPy, or can I use a new type of containers?
Okay, so the question is, can we use complex containers for type annotations, and are we limited to only what is defined in the typing module? So you can use any types of containers on any classes for the annotation. In this presentation, I used very simple types because I want to get the message through on simple types, but you can create your own types with containers, you can define some rules, so it's very open, and anything which is a class is actually a valid type and can be used for type annotations. Yeah, you can do list of tuples of whatever, or you can combine everything, sets, or it's very flexible. Yes, here?
Do you have experience of transitioning large real-life code bases from a non-type to type? In our case, we started with Python 2.7, now we are on 3.x. How complicated, how long is it?
No, I don't have experience on large projects. I did it on my own projects. So I forgot to put the line count, but it was it's a slow process. It's a slow process because the code is big, usually on big code base. You have to make sure you put the right type. So that's why you say go step by step. On my personal projects, but those were projects which were stable, I didn't find any, maybe one or two bugs, but mostly nothing. But the project were rock stable, so they were not in development. But I feel much more confident now that I have type annotations. When I will do the next evolution, I'm sure I will make less mistakes.
And so how would you do it, like putting your MyPy somewhere in your CI and,
yes.
And then just adding stuff?
Before you put in your CI, you put it locally. So that's one of my slides here. So you do one module, you check it, then you check the code base on. Sorry. The step by step approach is that you check one module with a dash dash strict, you fix all the errors, then you check all the code base. You fix all the errors, and then you run into integration. And MyPy becomes part of the integration, but you have to be very specific. You don't want to create thousands of errors at once in the integration. Yes?
I just was wondering if you could support dunder methods, if you, for example, add a dunder add, and then you have some
Yes, so not exactly in the way you specify it, but if you look at abstract base classes in the documentation, something that, let's say you can convert it to an integer, there's an abstract class that defines this, which is named a support int. So with this you can say it converts to an integer and it can be verified for it. So if you have a matching abstract class, it will support complex cases. If you have something very fancy, maybe it will not. It's possible to add the extra information with specific abstract classes, but abstract classes, I never dug into it. It looks a bit complicated to me. But for all the standard cases, you can say, OK, this can support integer addition. I guess this is something which already exists. So yes, there is both a very specific method can accept this type of argument, or very generic, I can accept an object which has a property that you should add it to integer. So both of them are covered in the typing module. And yes?
Is the standard library fully annotated?
The standard library is fully annotated. Yeah. So the question is, I must repeat the question. So the question is whether the standard library is annotated. So yes, it is. If you look at the code, you will not see the annotations. It's a separate, the annotations are provided separately into stubs. So stubs is basically a file where you just put type annotations. And there's a GitHub project to host all the stubs, both for Python 2.7 and for every version of Python, actually. And MyPy will use this when verifying the standard library. So the project is called TypeSced.
If you have a function that can return either none or something, do you have to use a union in the return annotation?
So question, yes. If I have a function which can return multiple types, either a known or a given type, should I use a union in the return type? Yes. So in this specific case, none on other value, you can also say optional of the other types. So yes, you have to be specific about what you return. And if you just saying integers on your return float, this will trigger an error, a MyPy error.
Yes.
No, I have not done it. Question is, can we type objects coming from an ORM? So the typical problem with ORM is that it converts a database object into a real-life object. But this is a very dynamic construct, usually. So you cannot statically define in advance what will be your object. So I don't know how to deal with this. You can, you would have to use extra mechanism, but I don't think it fits well the static type annotation scheme.
Yeah, I don't fully agree because like on most ORMs, like you use an object and you do like a model.get in the database. So in the end, maybe your top level class is populated.
So it really depends on the way you built your ORM. If you know in advance that when you get a specific field on a specific database object, you will get a specific type of object, then you can put type annotations everywhere. So in Django, a typical example. If your ORM is very dynamic, it's difficult to put static type information on it. So yeah, it depends on the use case. Generally, static code is safer. So the more you move into the static land, the more error you will be able to spot. Yes, another question?
Yes, for monkey type, can you review the additions before you apply them to the module you are using monkey type for?
I don't get the question, sorry.
Can you review the annotation that monkey will make for
you? Ah, yes. Monkey type. When you are using monkey type, and it modifies your source code. Yeah, there are several. Can you review the changes before it is applied? So when I do the example with apply, no, you cannot review it. But of course, you have source control, so you will see the differences. So that's one way of doing it. You can also just ask monkey type to show you all the prototypes that it has found. So it will show you all the stubs of all the methods, and you can review them before applying them. Anyway, monkey type will put type annotations. Don't take them as granted. You still need to review, make sure this is consistent, because maybe it did not capture everything, and you still want to put extra information. So the review process, if you are using MonkeyType, is still mandatory. It's a helper, it's not everything. Since it will also show you the types used in production, maybe it will miss some other cases, so you want to be careful. Okay, so I guess that's it. Thank you.